this session deals with experimental dynamos and other MHD experiments. There's a slight change in the program. So after Francois, Frank Stefani will give his talk. So the coffee break is shifted backwards to 11:15. And so let's start with the first presentation by Francois Petrelis on the Van Karman sodium experiment.
Good morning. Thank you for being here. So yes, I will talk about the Van Karman sodium experiment, which is a collaboration between three groups. So a group in Paris led by Stéphane Fauve, a group in Lyon led by Jean-François Pinton, and a group in Saclay led by François Davio. I plan to first describe the experiment, and then I'll discuss several results that we obtained related to the experiment. I discuss the instability and the mechanism of instability, then what happened above the onset of instability, and present some results of, on the amplitude of the generated magnetic field. Then I show you that there are some dynamical regimes that can be observed in the experiment, including reversal of the generated magnetic field and some other interesting behaviors. And I show you that all these regimes can be understood using a simple mechanism that I will present. So all that, maybe some of you have already heard it, but then the last part will be new, and I discuss some understanding we have on induction mechanism and possible application to astrophysical dynamo. So if you already heard the beginning, you just have to wake up there. I'll let you know. Okay. So the experiment, it's a cylinder that contains a little bit more than 150 liters of liquid sodium. Temperature of the sodium is maintained constant by a circulation of oil above the melting temperature of the sodium, roughly 100 degrees. And then the fluid is put into motion by the rotation of two disks that you can see here, the one of the disks here. The disks are fitted with 8 blades that enhance the driving of the fluid. And we have 300 kilowatts of motors to drive the flow. Therefore, the flow will be very, very turbulent. So the kind of flow we are exploring here have a kinetic Reynolds number very large and display very large fluctuations. So the flow are put into motion, the fluid is put into motion by the rotation of these disks. And we observe that if the disks are made of soft iron, and I'll come back to that a bit later, then we can observe the dynamo instability, which typical time series is represented here. So starting with a rotation of around 10 Hertz and increasing the rotation of the disks, the magnetic field, which is initially is very small, will increase roughly exponentially and then saturate to some value controlled by the nonlinear regime of the instability. So you already observe here that the fluctuations are quite large. And this traces back to the turbulent nature of the flow. Okay. Then, for now, I'm discussing what happened. You see, we have two disks that counter-rotate. So for now, I'm focusing on the case where the two disks counter-rotate with exactly the same speed. Okay, so we call that exact counter-rotation. And I'll talk about that a bit later. In that case, we can measure the field at different positions or measure the field and time average it. And then the time average magnetic field has this structure. So that, I insist, it's a time average field. It's made, it can be described as an axial dipole. So in green, the poloidal field, and in red, the toroidal field. So the time average field is an axial dipole that can point either to the right or to the left on this figure. Okay. What can we understand on that already? Interestingly, early numerical simulations studied what happened when we solved the induction equation considering only the time average velocity field. So then if you consider only the time average velocity field, people predict the existence of a transverse dipole, which is not what we observe. Why is it like that? Well, the time average velocity field is axis symmetric. So by cooling theorem, we cannot have an axial mode. The fact that we observe an axial mode means that non-axis symmetric fluctuations are important. More precisely, the mechanism operating is, we think, a shear, an omega effect, convert the poloidal field in green into the toroidal field in red. And then non-axis symmetric fluctuation, like swirling flow, close to the blade, form an alpha effect that converts the toroidal field into the initial poloidal field. So we have an alpha-omega dynamo here. And this, the spatial structure of the field is quite coherent with that. So I come back a little bit later on the role of the soft iron disk and the comparison with a numerical simulation. But now that we understand that I described the unstable mode and how it is formed, we can look at the property in the nonlinear regime, and in particular the magnetic energy, which is formed. So having the time series of the magnetic field, we can calculate B square, and we represented it as a function of the rotation frequency F, so B square as a function of F. And these data points here are made at different value of F and also different value of the temperature of the experiment. You can control the temperature by heating up or cooling down the experiment. And so we have all these set of points here. And what we observe is that these points will nicely rescale on a unique curve here. If we represent that quantity, B square mu zero sigma square R square over rho, as a function of Rm. Rm being defined by zero, sigma. So mu zero is the magnetic permeability of vacuum, sigma is the electrical conductivity of the fluid that depends on temperature, therefore the rescaling in Rm, and V is the typical velocity and L the typical length of the experiment. Okay, where does that come from? You can start by dimensional analysis. So if you write the parameter of the problem B mu zero, sigma L rho, nu, the kinematic viscosity, V and L, the velocity and the length of the flow, then the very general formula that relates the magnetic energy to the parameter of the problem can be written like that. So that's a general law that has to be verified by any experimental dynamo. Then we can make some progress by saying that the kinematic viscosity appears only here in PM, which is nu over eta. And for a turbulent flow with a kinetic Reynolds number larger than a million, like in the experiment, we expect that the transport of impulsion will not be achieved by the viscosity. Therefore, in other words, that nu will not appear in this scaling law. Having said that, we can drop PM here, and then we recover the predicted law that we tested just before. So C's formula for the magnetic energy is a function of Rm only. Can say a little bit more, maybe, if we assume that the dependence of B is the usual one for a supercritical bifurcation, so B proportional to the square root of the departure from onset, then we get B square equal to Rm minus Rmc. So C's law can be tested actually for the different experimental dynamos. They all fit nicely on the same graph here. So in red, we have the measurements taken from data from Riga experiment, in blue from Karlsruhe, and in green from VKS. And you see that this dimensional form for the magnetic energy is actually a function of Rm. So what's important here is not that they bifurcate for nearly close value of Rm. That's obviously the flow are different. So somehow it's a coincidence of the definition of Rm. But you see that the magnetic energy formed above onset is of the same order of magnitude for these three dynamo, which confirms the argument that the magnetic energy will be independent of the kinematic viscosity. Therefore, this number here should be of order one. Okay. So that's what I wanted to say on the regime that we observe when the two disks counter-rotate with the same speed. So we have a dipole that points either on one side or toward the other side of the experiment. We have lots of fluctuations. I show, yes?
Bigger is above VKS.
Yeah? No, it's, I mean, so the experiment is different. We're not making the measurement at the same point. We're not really evaluating the total magnetic energy, but measuring at one point. So we cannot discuss the difference between the curve on such arguments. No, there is no point. The only thing maybe we could say is that Riga and Karlsruhe seems to have a quite linear dependence in RM, here in RM minus RMC. More linear, at least, than the VKS experiment. So maybe this says something that the effect of the turbulent fluctuation are larger on the VKS experiment and are responsible for the curved shape of the magnetic energy as a function of RM, meaning somehow some anomalous behavior due to the effect of the fluctuations. That's the only thing we can discuss from that. Okay, so exact counter rotation, two possible states, magnetic field in one direction or magnetic field in the other direction, turbulent fluctuation, and yet there are no reversal. If we look in time, the dipole point always in the same direction, depending on the initial condition. This is not true anymore if we rotate one of the disks faster than the other one. So doing that, that may be the clear observation we had with this stuff that I run disk experiment, is that when one of the disks rotates faster than the other one, the stationary dynamo that we observed in red here will evolve toward another state in green. So that's the green volume here, or the black also triangles here. These are dynamical regions. So the magnetic field, if you look at the dipole component, it does not point always in the same direction, but it may in particular reverse. Okay, so you see the parameter space, speed of one disk, speed of the other disk. If the speed is small, there is no dynamo, that's the blue cross. And then if the speed is large enough, we observe a stationary dynamo if we are in exact counter rotation here. And then if we go away from exact counter rotation, we can observe dynamical regime, which I will describe more in detail just after. We have a complicated parameter space made of several windows of dynamical regimes. So the point, there are no dynamical regime in exact counter rotation, and I'll show you that this comes from a symmetry of the forcing, so we can make some exercise on geometry. Maybe it's not the right time to do that, it's a bit too early, but I try. So when the two disks counter rotate with the same speed, there is a symmetry in the forcing in the sense that rotating of by an angle pi around some around any axis in the midplane of the experiment will exchange the role of the two disks. So that's the symmetry of the forcing in exact counter rotation. That's called R, this rotation. If we rotate one disk faster than the other one, then we will break this symmetry. Okay, and I'll come back to that a bit later. Okay, let's see some example of dynamical regimes, such as nonlinear oscillation are represented here. So we rotate one disk faster than the other one, and then we can observe this time series. So it's a nonlinear oscillation. One of the components is almost doing a square periodic wave here. And the period of that is of the order of, let's say, 40 seconds, and seems to be quite robust. Despite the fluctuation, the period is nearly constant. We change a bit the parameter, and we can observe another kind of time series, such as this one. So that's what we call random reversal of the magnetic field. So let's describe that. During 30 minutes, here we observe, and 30 minutes is just because after we stopped the experiment. So we have fixed the value of the rotation frequency of the disk, so we are not changing the forcing. And the magnetic field will remain constant for several minutes, will remain of constant direction for several minutes, and then suddenly reverse toward the opposite polarity.
What are the blue and green colors?
So That's a probe. We're measuring the magnetic field with probes that measure the three components of the field here in the mid-plane. So that's the three components of the field. When I will tell you which modes are involved in the dynamics, then knowing the mode, it's easy to understand which component is which color is related to which mode. Okay. I won't go into detail to say you this is the azimuthal component, this is the toroidal component, this is the poloidal component. But we could do it. It doesn't bring you a lot of information, and it's a bit complicated to describe. Just say here, the direction is the same, and then suddenly change of direction. The time scale here is very short compared to the time scale during a fixed polarity. And there are several properties that are similar to with the geodynamo field as recorded by geophysicists. In part, so the scale separation between the duration of a reversal and the duration between a fixed polarity. And then you can see that at the end of a reversal, almost always you reach values that are larger than the value at saturation. So that's called an overshoot. And another property that you see directly from this time series here is that the magnetic field have some displays some events where it decreases, such as here, for instance, or here, just before the reversal, or here. So it decreases as if we wanted to reverse, but finally does not reverse. So it starts like a reversal, but does not complete the reversal. It's an aborted reversal, or what geophysicists call an excursion. Okay, we have a variety of regimes that we observe. So maybe I'll discuss two more regimes, bistable dynamos. So that's an example of time series we observe when one of the disks rotates at a very large frequency and the other disk rotates at a very low frequency. Actually, here, one of the disks is at rest, frequency zero, and we observe a stationary magnetic field here. So almost 30 goes in one direction. So magnetic field of which direction does not change with time. And then we change a little bit the speed of the disk. So we go to 1 hertz and then come back to rest. So here and here, the forcing is the same. But we have made some perturbation here. And we observe that the magnetic field has transitioned from stationary to a periodic oscillation. Okay. So for same forcing, here we observe either stationary or oscillating dynamo. It's a bistable dynamo. Statistical property can be of these different fields can be measured here with the magnetic energy. So you see in blue the bifurcation curve for the stationary dynamo. And above some frequency here, let's say 25 hertz, then this stationary dynamo is bistable with the oscillatory dynamo, which is observed here. Last dynamical regime I will present. There are other ones, but I won't go into detail. We observe that we were wondering what was the balance between magnetic energy on the two sides of the experiment. So we put a probe on both sides and then measure the magnetic energy close to disk one, let's say, call it E1, and then the magnetic field energy close to disk two, let's call it E2. And we measure close to exact counter rotation, what happened for the ratio E1 over the total magnetic energy. And that's, we represent it as a function of the departure from exact counter rotation. What we observed is in exact counter rotation, we have nearly 50% of this ratio here, meaning as much energy on the left side and on the right side. Now, if we rotate slightly faster the disk 2, that number becomes negative. And you see that the magnetic energy close to disk 1 becomes very large. Almost 90% of the energy is localized close to disk 1, even though we have broken the symmetry R by less than 10%. So it's a strong localization of the magnetic energy close to disk 1 when disk 2 rotates slightly faster than disk 1. Was, I think, the first experimental observation of localized dynamo like that. And I'll come back a bit later on maybe the relevance of this localized dynamo in the astrophysical context. Okay, so we have a variety of dynamical regimes, and we'd like to put some order in it. So what we did with Stéphane Fauve, Emmanuel Dormy, and Jean-Pierre Vallée was to try to capture the dynamics of the magnetic field using a low-dimensional model. So there have been different attempts to do that. I'm not reviewing them today, but what we will using a lot is the symmetry properties of the model. So for the VKS, I'm going to present the model now. The idea is to do a low-dimensional model. It's actually quite relevant if we are close to the onset of instability, because we expect only a few number of modes to be excited. But for the VKS experiment, it's actually quite natural to consider a small number of modes, so the dipolar modes that I have discussed earlier here, and then a second mode, which is just slightly more structured around the axis, which is sketched here, which is a quadrupolar mode. Okay? That's the two modes that will be, that we keep in the low dimensional description of the field and that we think are interacting in the VKS experiment. So the same model can be made exactly in the same way for the S. So I presented it simultaneously. So the idea is also to consider a first mode, which is sketched here, which is the dipolar mode, as nearly observed right now, and then consider a second mode that we have taken as a quadrupolar mode, which is sketched here. Obviously, that's a sketch. The field is more complicated than that. There's no. So the red arrow is a poloidal field, and the blue arrow is a toroidal field. The structure is more complicated. Just here, we represent the symmetries of this field with respect to the equator, which is a natural symmetry of the forcing for astrophysical objects, and with respect to the rotation of pi around the axis here, which is a symmetry for the VKS experiment. The important point is that the two modes have different symmetry with respect to this transformation. One is odd, one is even. We'll see that these physical ingredients, how the two modes transform with respect to the symmetry, has some influence on the low-dimensional equations that describe the competition between the two modes. And having understood that, we can understand why breaking the symmetry results in the dynamics that we observed. So let's do that. So why the magnetic field has the sum of some scalar amplitude of the dipolar field as sketched before, plus some quadrupolar amplitude multiplied by the quadrupolar field as sketched before. Close to onset, you expect to be able to write an equation for D plus IQ, let's write it A, the amplitude of the two modes, which you expect to have the form of a series in power of A. So you expect to be able to write A dot is mu A plus nu A bar, the linear part of the instability, plus nonlinear term. Because of the B give minus B symmetry of the MLG equation, there will be only cubic term at lowest order. So that's what we keep here. Can analyze this general equation here quite easily by introducing a phase equation. So writing A is R exponential I theta, and look for an evolution equation for theta. R cos theta will be the dipole, R sin theta will be the quadrupole, therefore theta tells you the relative importance of quadrupole and dipole. So a simplified form of the equation for theta is this one. So we put that in the equation, and we keep only linear term at that order. We can write it almost completely generally, I'll come back to that later, as theta dot is mu I minus nu r sine 2 theta. Mu r is a real part of nu. Mu I is the imaginary part of mu. Okay, subscript means real or imaginary part. Okay, that's very general. It's actually the phase equation for two modes close to onset at linear order. There is almost no physical ingredients here. But now we introduce the physics by saying that if the flow is symmetric, then this equation should be unchanged if we change D in minus D and Q in Q, and keeping Q unchanged. This means changing A in minus A bar. These symmetries of the system therefore translate into a constraint in the coefficient of the equation, which is that the imaginary part of the coefficient should be zero. Therefore, here mu I should be zero. Okay, so now we're going to describe the behavior of the solution of this equation, written here, and we see what happens when we break the symmetry, meaning when we increase the imaginary part of the coefficient, when we increase mu I.
So can you get this equation out of your MHD equations, or we just somehow give arguments that you expect an equation of this kind?
Okay, so in principle, close to an onset of instability, using normal form theory, we should be able to calculate explicitly this coefficient using weakly nonlinear analysis. That's true when for lamina or a time periodic system. In a turbulent flow, it's not that obvious. However, so in that case, the different coefficients have some very clear physical meaning. Here, for instance, nu r is the difference of growth rate between the dipole and the quadrupole. So it's a coefficient that is directly related to some physical property of the eigenmode. When we're turbulent, it's not obvious that we can watch a series like that. We'll see a bit later that we have somehow to put back the effect of the turbulence, in particular to observe the random reversals. Okay, so there is no rigorous base for Whiting-Seed equation. I guess the most convincing fact is that it captures all the regime we observe. Okay. It won't be always true on a turbulent regime, though. What do you mean?
A squared?
Okay, the MHD equation, the usual approximation, is invariant if you change B in minus B. Therefore, there are no quadratic terms. They all go to zero. That would not be true if we are considering all effects, for instance. Okay, so let's discuss the property of the solution of this equation. So stationary solution, you see, suppose mu I is zero, for instance, stationary solution will be solution of sine 2 theta equals zero. So 2 theta equals zero of pi. Okay, so theta equals zero, pi over 2, pi, 3 pi over 2. So that's the solution represented here, blue square and red circle. So here I've represented here when mu I is non-zero as a small positive value. And we have four solutions to this equation that equals zero. Two are stable and two are unstable here. Then if you start with an initial condition somewhere, you'll be attracted towards a stable solution here or the opposite one. Then if we increase mu I, these two solutions get closer and disappear. If mu I is larger than u r, there is no stationary solution anymore, only an oscillatory solution. So that's a sudden node bifurcation. It explains how you transition from a stationary dynamo toward a time periodic dynamo, nonlinear oscillating. You can understand that quite easily by noting that this equation is actually the evolution of a particle of position theta in a potential V represented here, right? And the potential transition from, if mu I is small, the potential has a series of minima and maxima. So that the stable solution and the opposite stable solution. And then if mu I is large, this potential becomes monotonous. The particle will go down the hill here, meaning you will rotate around the circle here. So you transition from stationary to a nonlinear oscillation. A comparison between time series can now be made. So that's a small part of the nonlinear oscillation we have seen before, and the black and blue curve are the solution of the low dimensional equation A dot is the series in A, having fixed the coefficient. So the agreement is nearly perfect, but obviously there are a lot of fitting parameters. Right. So the fact that the agreement is so good is not so relevant. But what's important is to notice that despite the very large kinetic Reynolds number of the flow, if you want to describe this periodic oscillation here, you need to keep only two modes. So that's for the periodic oscillation. Now, I think an interesting prediction that can be made from this scenario is actually what happens if we slightly below the onset of the saddle node bifurcation. So we're in the regime where we have a series of minima like that. So the particle here, depending on the initial condition, will stick in one of the minima. So stick close to the stable solution or the opposite stable solution. Now, remember that there are fluctuations, turbulent fluctuations in the system. So a first guess of the effect of the turbulent fluctuation would be to say that it will push the particle and force it to wander close to the minima of the potential here. So the particle will wander here, explore a bit the phase space close to a stable solution. And then what happens if the fluctuation drives you here, for instance? If you're here, you won't come back here in general. You will go down the hill. Okay, so fluctuation push you away from the basin of attraction of the stable solution here. And then you are attracted toward the opposite stable solution. That's a reversal. Okay, that's the mechanism for the reversal. Interestingly, you can predict several things from that scenario. So a reversal first is made of two phases. First, fluctuation drives you against the slope here. So you go uphill here. And then you go down the hill. So you expect to have two phases. The first one will be slow because you have to go against the deterministic dynamics. And then the second one will be fast because you go down the hill. So a slow phase followed by a fast phase. At the end of the first phase, I told you you would go there. But actually, if you're just at the top, you can also come back. So it starts, you start like a reversal, but you don't reverse and you go back to the initial polarity. It's an aborted reversal or an excursion. That's a scenario for excursion. And then you can even compare what will be some fine detail of the excursion on the reversal by noting that thing. At the end of the reversal, if you're interested in the dynamic of the dipolar component, you see that you reach large value, larger than the value of the stable solution. So at the end of the reversal, you reach a large value of D and then saturate. While at the end of the excursion, you come back from below here. Okay, you do that. So you don't reach large value before saturating. So there is a difference between what happened at the end of a reversal and an excursion. In one case, you will have an overshoot for the reversal and not for the excursion. Now that's something you can predict from that scenario. So you can check this prediction, which I listed here, by taking you the low order model, theta dot is the sum of the two terms, alpha 0, alpha 1 sine 2 theta, add some noise that represent the effect of the turbulent fluctuation, and then calculate the dipole. So you have a low dimensional model with some stochasticity that describes the dynamics of the dipole. Time series of the models are represented here, VKS equation for the VKS experiment here, and then that's since 2000, so it's a time series of the geomagnetic dipolar field for the last 2 million years. So several properties are common to whole this situation. Long duration of fixed polarity, very brief reversal. Overshoot at the end of the reversals. And existence of excursion. So that's observed on the three time series. If you want to look more in detail on the properties and on the scenario we have presented before, you can zoom on what happened for the reversal and for the excursion. So that's all the reversal for the model in gray, and for VKS that's the different realization. In black, that's the average over the different realization. That's what is recorded for the four last reversals, and that's for the excursion. I think in all cases, you see clearly that reversal is made of a slow phase followed by a fast phase. And I guess you can convince yourself that there are overshoot at the end of the excursion, even on most of the Earth dipole reversals, and that these overshoot are not observed on the excursion. So all that is completely in line with what we have predicted. Okay, so our low dimensional model describes the nonlinear oscillation, the random reversals. There are other dynamical regimes I've presented, so I'm not going to go into detail, but it also completely captures what happened for the bistable dynamo, so we can understand the bistability between a stationary an oscillatory dynamo by looking at the equation for A close to some value of the in the parameter space. And then, okay, so that's for the dynamical regimes that involve oscillating dynamo. So that they all are understood in the context of the competition between the dipole and the quadrupole. There was another one I mentioned, which are localized dynamo, which we observed in the experiment. I guess it's interesting because some astrophysical dynamo are also hemispherical. So as we discussed during a talk on Monday, the sun during Monday minimum, there were very few sunspots. Okay, so the number of sunspots here is very small compared to what is usually recorded. And almost all the sunspots are in the Southern hemisphere. Data on the remnant magnetization at the surface of Mars is also completely localized in one of the hemispheres. And some people have said that this could be an hemispherical dynamo, so a dynamo operating only in one hemisphere. So that's indirect measurements of the field, I agree. It's not 100% sure that what is observed here really means that the magnetic field was localized in one hemisphere. But it's still a good indication, I guess, at least for the Mondor minimum. But what is very clear is that there are numerical simulations of geodynamo or astrophysical dynamo in which people observed localization of the magnetic field in one hemisphere. So initially, I think Rother and Busse, and more recently, Landau and Aubert, and more people in the last years. So it seems that these hemispherical dynamos that we observed in the experiment are also maybe relevant for astrophysical dynamos. And we can actually understand them from the low-dimensional model. So we came to that during the PhD of Basil Gallet, who was working on a model for astrophysical dynamo in which we could investigate the effect of breaking the equatorial symmetry. The model is you take a sphere of conducting fluid in vacuum, and then you have alpha effect which are localized on two small layers. Two layers here on which are localized alpha effect. You prescribe the dependence of this alpha effect on the latitude here. So you can take alpha effect which will be equatorially symmetric, and then you change the value of the coefficient, and then the system won't be equatorially symmetric anymore, and you look on what happened to the solution of the dynamo equation, of the mean field equation. So starting from a configuration where you would observe a dipole, by breaking the symmetry, you could observe reversal of this dipole here. So the dipole pointing in that direction here, at the end will point in that direction, and in between, you observe that the reversal starts by having the opposite polarity in one hemisphere, and then in here, you observe clearly a quadrupole. So clearly, that's the scenario, transition from dipole to a quadrupole to the opposite dipole. That was quite interesting, but what's...
Can you repeat once more? What do you do to alpha to break the symmetry?
Say again?
What did you do to alpha to break the symmetry?
Oh, so alpha depends on latitude. It's some function like cos theta, cos 2 theta, cos 3 theta. And we, starting from a solution where we keep only equatorially symmetric alpha, we increase the value of the coefficients that break the equatorially symmetric. There are different ways to do that, actually two ways to do that. One of the way we result in this oscillation and reversal of the field. And another way, if we change the coefficient, we observe that. So the magnetic field is stationary, the solution is stationary, and is localized in one hemisphere. 95% of the energy is in the Southern hemisphere. Yeah. So you might think, okay, you break the symmetry, that means you forced stronger in one hemisphere, therefore you have a stronger field in that hemisphere. That's not that. Remember that symmetry breaking effects are very small here. Okay, they are less than 1% of the symmetric ones. Despite this very small breaking of symmetry, you have a very strong localization of the magnetic energy in one hemisphere. Going back to the VKS experiment, we rotate one disk 10% quicker than the other one. The magnetic field energy localized close to the slower disk. Okay, so you don't localize close to the faster disk. You don't localize close to where you're forcing faster in the experiment. So it's more complicated than just large forcing implies large magnetic energy. Where does that come from? It's also a competition between a dipole and a quadrupole. Actually, looking back at the equation for theta, at linear order, the equation for theta, and here are all the terms, is theta dot is mu I plus nu I cos 2 theta minus nu R sine 2 theta. Breaking equatorial symmetry means that the imaginary part of the coefficient becomes large, as I said before. We discussed what happened when mu I became large. That was a reversal. But you see that mu I also can become large. There are two ways, two possibilities, either mu I or nu I become large. If nu I become large, what happened? The solution remains stationary. Solution of cos 2 theta equals 0. Therefore, 2 theta is pi over 2. Therefore, theta is pi over 4. So the solution remains stationary. Theta is pi over 4, meaning there are as much dipole and quadrupole. So you have to add up a dipole and a quadrupole are filled. In one of the hemispheres, they will add up because they're in the same direction. And in the opposite hemisphere, they will subtract the opposite direction. So you will have a low, very low energy one hemisphere and very high energy in the other hemisphere. That's an hemispherical dynamo. So hemispherical dynamo can also be understood by the competition between the dipole and the quadrupole. And all the dynamical regime I've presented and some other ones like symmetric and asymmetric burst result from the competition between these two modes. Christoph Giesinger, already a few years ago, actually verifying the experiment that there is a quadrupolar field and that the energy is exchanged between the dipolar field and the quadrupolar field. So we have confirmation of that in the experiment. Maybe one thing is there is no need for a large change of the flow to generate reversal or periodic oscillation. If you're close enough to the sudden node bifurcation, even moderate fluctuation can trigger reversals. Okay, so what we learn from that, I guess, is that a scenario for a reversal does not have to imply a very strong modification of the flow. Okay. If you have a strong modification of the flow, that can trigger dynamical event for the magnetic field, that's obvious. But you don't need that. Okay. So that's what I wanted to say on the dynamical regime of the magnetic field. Now, I briefly come back to what I discussed initially, the mechanism for generation of the dynamo, and in particular, the role of the soft iron disks. So the experimental fact is that we don't observe dynamo if the disk and blades are not ferromagnetic. So we tried with copper disks or stainless steel disks, and we didn't see dynamos. So that means that if the magnetic permeability is 1, there is no dynamo, which more precisely means that the critical magnetic Reynolds number for the onset of the dynamo is larger than what is achievable experimentally, okay, and could be infinity. Okay, but you have to remember that we can only probe small value of small value for the maximum magnetic Reynolds number. So to investigate the effect of ferromagnetic material, initially people did numerical simulation. So Giesinger, Giesecke, Nor, involving the group of Giesecke and of Frank Stefani and other people, like Jacques Léora, I guess. So these people try to model the effect of ferromagnetic material by saying that, okay, so high magnetic permeability, we can consider that it's infinity. Therefore, we can use a limit of infinite magnetic permeability for the disk, which simplifies the boundary condition for the magnetic field, which has to be normal to the boundary. Doing that, they observed dynamo with an onset smaller than a mu r equal 1, but slightly larger than in the experiment. Okay? So, recently, during the PhD of John and Hero, we have showed that actually there may exist an optimum value of mu r that minimizes RMC. In other words, if you draw the critical magnetic Reynolds number of a dynamo as a function of mu r, it doesn't have to be monotonous. It can be like that. So there is some value of mu r that minimizes the value of the critical magnetic Reynolds number at the onset of the dynamo. So I have no time here to explain in detail why there is this optimum value, but I'll be happy to discuss if anybody is interested. Then, with that interpretation, the role of the soft iron disk is to lower the onset of a mode that would be a dynamo, but at an higher value of the magnetic Reynolds number without iron disks. So, as you've seen here, there has been some effort recently to understand what happened when we change the physical property of the fluid here at the boundaries, changing mu r. So now I will go away from VKS. And so the question we're going to go to is, generally, what do you expect for the dynamo when the physical property of the fluid are non-homogeneous? So two trivial questions. Are the physical property of the Earth liquid core or the sun convective zone or the galaxy uniform? We've seen the talk on the galaxies that the temperature would fluctuate of 4 orders of magnitude, for instance. So obviously, the physical properties are not uniform. More precise question, how large are the variations of electrical conductivity in the system? So it depends on which system you're considering, and I suppose there is no definite answer to that. So there is space for investigation on whether there is an effect on the dynamo of the variation of electrical conductivity in the bulk of the flow. Okay, so that's a work that involves Alexandros, Christophe Gissinger, and Stefan Fo. So if we want to see what the variation of electrical conductivity, sigma, what's their effect on a dynamo, we go back to the induction equation when sigma depends on space, which is written here, and introducing the magnetic diffusivity, we have eta is, we write eta is eta naught plus delta eta, so variation of conductivity amounts to variation in magnetic diffusivity. Putting that in the equation, we have a modified dynamo equation, which is the usual induction equation, plus a new term here that represents the effect of variable electrical conductivity.
So, by magnetic diffusivity, you mean effective one or sometimes molecular one?
Molecular one. Okay, that's what we're thinking. So, we have this equation, but different things can be attempted on this equation. And so what we're going to do is, one thing we could do is use scale separation, okay, as Andrew Soward has done a lot, to calculate the effect of varying conductivity on the magnetic field. So that's how you do the calculation for the alpha effect, and I will very briefly summarize it. So we assume that V and eta varies on a small length scale, L, and we define the average over this length scale, L. So we can write the total magnetic field as a sum of the average magnetic field, noted with bracket, plus some fluctuation, average B plus fluctuating B. We put that in the equation, and we obtain quite easily an equation for the large scale field, which has this form here, so usual time variation, diffusivity. And then there are two terms here, the average of V cross B and the average of delta eta curl B. What is nice in scale separation is that we can obtain a closed equation for B. Indeed, the small scale magnetic field is solution of this equation here. And we can express B as a function. So there are some hypotheses, some limit to take to be in that regime. I don't discuss it here, but you can write here. You can write it clearly. And then you can obtain B as a function of large B. Therefore, calculate this different term here. And the equation is closed. So that's very standard. The first part is the alpha effect, the V cross B term. For instance, you can solve it in Fourier. You Fourier transform this equation so that the V bracket term are Fourier component of the field. And the first term here, the V cross B term, is something that everybody knows, it's the alpha effect. But nothing special here. You recognize something related to the helicity here. But there is a new term, so the second term, delta eta curl B, which you can calculate also. from the equation, and it has this expression here, which you can simplify by introducing the vorticity, omega equal curl V. If you introduce the vorticity, then the tensor alpha sigma, I noted alpha sigma here, has this expression here. So we can get physical insight from that. K is a wave vector over which are varying diffusivity and vorticity. And you will have a large value of the alpha tensor if you have correlation between diffusivity variation and gradient of the vorticity. Something else you can say is that you create a current in the direction of vorticity. So let's try to understand with the ends is mechanism. So I say correlation between diffusive variation and gradient of vorticity, and it creates a current in the direction of vorticity. So let's consider a vortex here. So that's the flow here, V in black. And we applied a magnetic field along the X direction. Here.
10 minutes.
10 minutes, very good. So V cross B will be responsible for an electromotrice force which is pointing toward you on that side and in the opposite direction on that side, V cross B. Okay, so an electromotrice force that would drive a current towards you here and away from you here. Now, if you consider variation of electrical conductivity, if you have a low electrical conductivity here and a large electrical conductivity here, the electromotrice force will create a small current on that side and a larger current on that side. Because sigma is larger here than here. Therefore, you have if you average over the flow here, you have a net current going in the y direction away from you. So you convert a magnetic field in a current, in a transverse direction. The current here is aligned with the direction of the vorticity. Okay, so that's exactly what we described before. It looks like it's a two-step mechanism, V and then sigma. So it's the kind of mechanism that can be efficient. So that's already interesting. I guess maybe the most interesting point is that we realize that some anti-dynamo theorem do not apply here. So in particular, we can have a dynamo with a planar flow. So take this velocity. Let's just take an example to check that. So this velocity, cos ky sine kz on x, cos kx sine kz on y, and zero on the z direction. So the flow is in a plane. It's actually a cellular flow which amplitude is modulated in the z direction. So take that for the velocity field and consider that expression for the variation of conductivity. You put that in the equation. It's easy to calculate that the usual alpha effect is zero, obviously because the flow is planar. But the other effect here is non-zero. It has a simple expression. So you have an alpha sigma, this new effect operating here, and you can look in the equation for the large scale field whether there will be a growing mode. So for a magnetic field that depends on Z only, varying with K, so a small wave vector in the Z direction, you can calculate the growth rate here. T is delta, the variation of diffusivity, square root of AB, the amplitude of the velocity field, times K over 8 minus dissipation. Therefore, in scale separation, if K is small, P is positive, and you will have a dynamo with this planar flow. So maybe you can drop the asymptotics. So, okay, we have another example with a planar flow, even a bit more simple, that depends on less coordinates. We can check that using a flow K code so that Alexandros has written and studied. So we can calculate the growth rate P for the flow I mentioned before as a function of kappa for different value of the variation of diffusivity and of the magnetic Reynolds number. So you see it starts linear, and then there is a quadratic damping that starts to act. And for all these values of the large scale wave vector, you will have a dynamo. Okay, so that's confirmed. And the continuous line is the asymptotic, which for small value of the variation of diffusivity is in complete agreement with what is measured experimentally, measured numerically. Okay? So, just to conclude, is there some interest of that in the geo or stellar or galactic dynamo context? I won't be difficult in which context it's relevant. So, usually when we do models of MHD dynamo, we consider uniform electrical conductivity. And then fast rotation renders the flow two-dimensional. And somehow what happens is that two-dimensional flows are non-dynamo. So that makes the problem complicated, right? In particular, that's why direct numerical simulation do not observe dynamo at very low Ekman. Fast rotation, the flow is almost 2D or completely 2D, and there is no dynamo. But if we consider varying electrical conductivity, then low dimensionality is not a problem anymore. So, okay, in considering two-dimensional flow, or varying electrical conductivity, we can take a simpler flow, two-dimensional, and then there is no problem of anti-dynamo theorems. So that seems nice for fastly rotating dynamos. So just I briefly present some simulations that Christoph Giesinger is running on models on a direct numerical simulation of MHD equation with variable conductivity using parody, the code that Emmanuel presented last week, or some value of the parameter. I just want to mention that, for instance, for this parameter regime, the growth rate of the transverse dipole is increased by the conductivity variation. So the growth rate as a function of data increases linearly. So starting from a situation where you would have no dynamo without variation of the electrical conductivity, then you obtain a dynamo. And my last slide will be this one, sketch of the unstable mode, and it's not for scientific reason, but for commercial reason. And I stop on that. Thank you for your attention. But you had a paper where you took infinite mighty parameter. At least Caroline,
Second remark, the last thing is very, very interesting, but I would like to remind you of this paper of Busse and Wicht.
Yes.
93. The approximately is the same. Maybe not exactly, but they have also found a dynamo where you have variation of the sigma.
Yeah, so... Yes, well, I modify my talk a little bit, so that part disappears. So Busse and Wicht had studied what happened when you close to a boundary which property change in space. So he considered something where sigma, so that's a boundary, and here you have a flow, for instance, a shear flow, and sigma varies with space here. So that's the effect of a boundary of varying electrical conductivity on the dynamo. In the paper you mentioned, in the first comment, you mentioned that there might be the same effect for VKS using U. We studied that during the PhD of Basile Gallet. This effect, when it's at the boundary, the efficiency is very minute, very moderate. Critical magnetic resonance numbers are scary for achieving dynamo with this effect. What we did was considering that the conductivity varies in the bulk of the flow, and then scale separation may help, and it does indeed. So you have a dynamo that can be very, very efficient at scale separation. Yeah, no, they're not equivalent, no. I mean, they're not equivalent. Also, there is some symmetry in the equation from one to another.
Okay, let's start with David. Could you speak up?
B will be delta eta B over L, right? So if L is very large compared to small L, system will be smaller. Okay? You actually, in first order smoothing, you should keep also minus V dot gradient of B bar for the same reason as you're mentioning. And you're not doing because you're looking in scale separation and B bar is nearly uniform. That's when you want to go further than first order smoothing. You want to see the effect, finite effect of the magnetic Reynolds number of the flow on B. That will be next order. No?
Yeah, maybe.
Okay, trust me.
Okay, wait.
Chris? In your VKS, you found steady solutions, you found oscillatory solutions, are sort of Earth-like.
But we were kind of lucky. In parameter space, so when you have a stationary domain, and then here you'll have an oscillatory domain, The random reversal are observed at the boundary. So here, okay. And what controls the width of the boundary is the importance of the fluctuations, okay. So that's very understandable from the low dimensional model also. You have random reversal if you're in the regime where you still have minima of the potential and fluctuation overcomes this minima.
You wouldn't actually see much of this, yeah.
If you decrease the fluctuation, you have to compare the importance of the fluctuation and the depth of the potential well here.
Yeah.
Okay. So there is one control parameter here. So you have a regime. If you increase the fluctuation, then you have a regime where you will have no reversal, then you will have random reversal, and then you will have something very fluctuating. Now, if you're changing the slope of the potential here, you transition from steady to oscillatory, and then other domain of width deeper proportional or increasing with the fluctuation, you'll have random reversals.
Certainly true, because reversals in dynamo models, DNS models, are usually observed in a not too wide parameter range.
So, the important point is, okay, you need to compare, what you need to compare to describe in which regime you are, is actually the difference of growth rate between the dipolar mode and the quadrupolar mode, and the amplitude of the fluctuation. Okay. Random effects, random reversal, are expected when the fluctuation are at least larger than the difference of growth rate between the two modes. For some still not very clear reason, in many cases, the dipolar mode and the quadrupolar mode, at least in models, are very similar growth rate, right?
And one more comment on that?
That's the case in VKS. In VKS, the two modes are similar growth rate.
One comment, that's true for the kinematic phase, but if you go highly supercritical, the dynamo settles into a regime where its growth reverses. So I think it's not an accident. You're highly supercritical, it benches out of it, and then it's very irregular that you are in the reversing state.
I enjoyed very much your talk. And I have one naive question, because you are interested in the large scale structure effect.
Answering just from the mathematical point of view of the asymptotic calculation here, we're doing it at first order in scale separation. So we're still not taking into account magnetic diffusivity. That would be at next order. Okay. So therefore, in scale separation, you expect this effect to be stronger than the magnetic diffusivity.
Sure. Yeah. So in your analysis, you're assuming that you're near the outset, right? For the bifurcation theory. But for the solar dynamo, we are far away from the outset. Do you think some of these ideas will go through?
So, in principle, if you're far above onset, there are lots of modes that can be involved in the dynamics. Therefore, the approach keeping only two modes should not be relevant. Still, for the solar dynamo, the oscillation is very nearly to be periodic, a very good periodic oscillation, meaning maybe keeping only a few modes and only two modes would be okay. I don't say that's what happened, but at least it can give a qualitative description of what's going on. I know that people are doing solar dynamo, say that this low-dimensional model cannot capture the oscillatory behavior. But then they have to explain why the solution is so periodic.